Welcome to the Art of Marketing Operations, a Taylor podcast. I'm Glenn Bottomley, and today my guest is Eric Eaton, Director of Marketing Operations at Carrot Fertility, an organization which helps employers and health plans provide equal access to high-quality and personalized fertility care and family farming globally. Thanks for joining me today, Eric.
Yeah, thanks, Glenn. Super stoked to be here.
Well, Eric, when you and I first met, we learned that you and I are both vegan.
That's right.
So can you just share a bit about why eating a vegan diet is important to you? And then we'll get into marketing operations.
Yeah, for sure. You're adding me already early on. So been vegan for about 8 years. I made the switch, not to sound too cheesy, but for me, it just came down to compassion. You know, there's a lot of noise in the world. And so if I could just switch my diet or make one lifestyle choice to reduce just a little bit of harm, why wouldn't I? So been doing it for 8 years, still alive, still don't have a protein deficiency yet. I'm loving every minute of it.
Oh, that's fantastic. Yes, the protein question is a very common question I've always received as well. I turned vegetarian 32 years ago and vegan 22 years ago. So good for you. I'm glad you made that choice. So good for you.
That's awesome.
Okay, so let's go ahead and switch gears to our primary topic today, marketing operations. Now, throughout your career, you have worked your way up from, you know, entry-level marketing positions all the way to a director of a global company. So what have been some of the keys to your success as you've transitioned from one role to the next, each with obviously increasing levels of responsibility?
Yeah, that's a good question. So I came in as an intern at my first company, pretty non-traditional background. I was in the Navy for 6 years, jumped into kind of the startup world. And the one thing for me, and this is going to sound pretty cheesy, but I always think about there's this model that we always said, like shipmate self. And so are you making the right decisions by your company, by your team, and then by you? And it's really just about like, do you really own what you're doing? And regardless of whatever level you're at, if you're a specialist sending out emails and doing list uploads, or a manager doing integrations or talking about lead scoring, it's really the same. Are you making the right decisions at the company level? Are you making the right decisions at your team level? And then lastly, are you making it so it's scalable for you? And something that I've noticed that I see a lot of people that have a high degree of success is what they'll do is whatever your job is, you try to learn what comes after you and what comes before you. And so I remember when I was in the early days, when I just got my first specialist job, actually, I was doing Marketo, and I didn't really understand like content syndication. Why do we do it? How are they getting the names? Where are they going to SDRs, right? And so it allowed me to really know, like, hey, my job is a small little part of just taking this list upload, putting it on Marketo, and sending a follow-up email. But how can I make it better so that way the scoring's actually accurate of what the sales team wants? Or how can I see where we're getting these names and making sure that's a legitimate opt-in process where they really know that it's me or the company interacting with them? And that's mm-hmm. at specialist level or even now at director level, right? Some of the initiatives that I'm doing is impacting all demand gen before me and their strategy, and then turning around, how's it impacting the sales org on a much grander level? And I've found that regardless of what level I'm at, as long as you think about what comes before you and what comes after you, you're pretty much gearing yourself up for success.
Yeah, it's sort of like in track and field, there's a relay. Someone is coming towards you with the baton, and then you've got to grab the baton, and then you've got to run your portion, and then you've got to hand that baton off. And so understanding the challenges of the team that came before and where you're handing to, it's super helpful to your point about just being as efficient as possible through that process. So I love that. I think that's great. And then at your current firm, at Carrot, I know that you need to communicate the value of your services to both employers and to their employees. So that's obviously a unique, sort of business model. So what are some of the key challenges that you have faced when communicating the same service, but with different brand value positioning to multiple audiences?
Yeah, that's a heavy hitting question. That's a great question, but kind of how we look at it. And so actually, if you think on the B2B side, right, so we're selling to employers, to health plans, we're dealing with, dealing is probably a bad word, but we're also talking to consultants. We're talking to a bunch of different stakeholders on the B2B side. And then on the B2C or the member side, it's we're really helping people that are going through their family forming journeys, whether it's IVF or adoption or egg freezing, even menopause, right? Whatever it is, we have to support them. So the messaging that we're using, how we really look at it is really through like a diversity, equity, and inclusion lens, especially on the member side, right? So maybe it's we did a fertility awareness month. But that's not really relevant to everybody. Sometimes that's a sensitive subject, especially at a global company where the perception of IVF is going to be drastically different between India and the U.S. So it's really trying to boil down and tailor that message to be extremely personable, and also offer different routes. So when we talk about fertility awareness or fertility benefits, we do want to include more than just, hey, the standard IVF. Like, we're also talking about adoption, really keeping whether it's B2B or members, really making sure that we're cementing in diversity among even the images or how we're talking and making sure that we're inclusive of everybody. And what's fun about that is I think that shows through a lot of the people are the people on buying committees that purchase Carrot. Like, they really do care. It's a big DEI initiative for them. And like, the champions are really passionate about the benefit. And those are the best people to work with because they care about how it goes down to their members or to their employees. And oftentimes when we're going to companies and saying, you know, we offer this great benefit, it's good for DEI, other people see it like, hey, maybe it's a retention tool or a recruitment tool, which is true, right? I mean, even for myself, I came to Carrot, I was like, this is a great mission. This is awesome. It's a cool benefit. And a lot of places don't offer something that's really inclusive. It's not a traditional benefit. And I think that's what makes it interesting. And so how you talk about it at the employee level, like they can use it for retention, recruitment, DEI. At the member level, it's really like serving a purpose that's traditionally not served through health plans or through insurance, excuse me. So it's just interesting. And it's cool when you do send out a message and sometimes you say like, hey, I'm not interested in fertility or I'm not that stage in my life anymore, but I am interested in, I'm going through menopause. What do you offer? Or I'm having a normal pregnancy. And so there's a lot of challenges regardless of who you're emailing, but really making sure that the core of your message does have that DEI element. And you're really trying to think about inclusivity.
Mm-hmm. That is really a great description of, I think, all of the various journeys that you are addressing and supporting, as you just described. And one of the things that sort of came to my mind as you were describing that, you talked about the emails going out and so forth, but I also think about sort of physical marketing impressions, you know, things like, signage or direct mail or, other physical marketing materials in addition to digital. How are you finding, or what has been your experience in the blending of both physical marketing impressions as well as digital marketing impressions such as emails, as you mentioned?
That's a good question. So we do some direct mail, both members and to B2B. And I think it's the same thing. Sometimes a lot of people get carried away with direct mail, especially in the B2B space. I'm sure you've seen this. Like, all of a sudden you'll have a toy helicopter show up in the mail and it has nothing to do with the company, right? Like, they're just trying to throw swag at you, so you have to take a call. And I think the fun part is, and I'll totally highlight one of my coworkers, Elise. She's the ABM manager. She did this phenomenal campaign really centered around LGBTQ+ in the community, and sending out direct mail that was like, hey, it is this inclusive benefit. This is what we offer. And we offer it to anybody regardless, right? So like, doesn't matter what your race, your gender, your sexuality, or even your income level, because we're reducing that barrier. And so when we sent that direct mail, we got like a pretty phenomenal response of people posting on LinkedIn, like, wow, this is really neat and thoughtful. And I think we try to do that with everything, right? We try not to get too cheesy with swag or send like AirPods, like send something that's going to actually add value in description to what you're doing. And so far we've seen pretty good response. And it's been pretty exciting because it's new on the B2B side, really. Kind of these tailored direct mail, as well as members, we're doing direct mail to members, and we see pretty good engagement there as well. And it's the same thing in all of our direct mail. We really try to focus on DEI. And so, like, are we really showing what the community is, right? It's not the standard, like, male, female, baby, right? Maybe we need to show some adoption or some diversity and really try to highlight the community that we're here for. And so regardless if it's physical or digital, we try to carry that through all the way.
That's excellent. And I think that's really good to also share the sensitivity to your point that really kind of reinforces the DE&I component that you just mentioned. So thank you. Now, I also know that a passion of yours is helping marketing teams succeed by, you know, obviously incorporating these, you know, really effective marketing operation strategies. So question, if you were providing advice to, say, a marketing leader who was just starting to implement marketing operation strategies, what would you advise? And then conversely, let's say you are providing advice to a marketing leader who's got extensive marketing operations experience, what would you advise? So both ends of the sort of the experience spectrum, what would you share?
Yeah, I think for a lot of, so I really love joining growth companies where they don't have marketing ops. It's like a new role for them. And what I've seen and a lot of hiccups I've seen, especially with senior leaders, right? CMOs and VPs of marketing, is they get married to platforms and they're not really solving the problem. All they know is like, hey, I need this ABM platform. And it's really going to rock and roll and it's going to make ABM successful. And really what it's doing is just showing ads, right? On a wide level. And it's a small, small part of your ABM strategy. And I've seen that a lot. So I would say go in with an open mind, really think about your strategy. What's the value you're trying to add to your prospects or customers? What are the channels? What do you really need? A lot of people just get hung up on these big, huge brand names and they think as long as they have Marketo or Adobe, right, they're going to be fine. And the truth is some of the best marketing teams, have platforms you never even heard of. They just have a really great strategy, really great content. And they're really trying to solve problems and build value for the prospects. And so that's what I would do for somebody new. I would say, like, go in with an open mind. And what I've seen a lot with senior operations owners or directors or VPs, a lot of people are very they hold, like, their processes, like, it's theirs, right? It's their baby. And, like, at least kind of the point of view that I've taken, and I think it's a healthy point of view, is, like, we should have open discussion. We should be able to beat up any idea, right? Nothing's off the table. Even if something, I remember when I was first getting into marketing ops, I saw a post and somebody's like, marketing ops is there to be the person that says no or to wrangle people in. And you could think that way. I personally don't. I think like marketing ops should be the enablement. We should be testing and trying to fail and see what works and what doesn't work. And I think that's the newer mentality of marketing ops, but there still is some that hold off with a lot of the senior leaders in the space of like, this is how I've done it. This is how I will always do it. And change is great. Like you should be willing to change. You should be able to poke holes in your ideas. That's half the fun of the job is really beating up and massaging your ideas, you know?
Yeah. Well, and to your point, it's in doing that that allows growth to happen and to foster. And I know that when you and I chatted before, that's one of the key areas that you love is scaling and, you know, how you bring an organization to rapidly scale, you know, marketing operations. So could we go down that path for a second? Could you share some stories of like maybe how you've scaled teams in the past and how you've scaled processes or MarTech stacks?
Yeah, for sure. I can, I'll give you an example even currently that we're using is kind of more around team. So when we first built marketing operations here at Carrot, there was a thought of maybe, hey, why don't we split this out to be B2B and B2C, and we'll all have one marketing org, but really we specialize in both of the audiences. And what we found is that was great. It worked. We had some areas of specialty, but there was so much knowledge that we were getting on both sides that could benefit from it, right? Like as we did email testing with members, that translated with demand gen. And as demand gen was working with certain clients, we were able to bring that over into systems and processes. And so we actually moved away from that and we just became one marketing operations organization and specialized more into, I would say, like layers. So we have campaign operations, people that really focus on list uploads, emails, kind of traditional marketing ops. We have somebody that specializes in analytics across both tech stacks. And so that way they really understand what are the inputs and outputs and what's this report team reporting on and what's that team reporting on. And then we also have somebody heading up our platform integrations and APIs and kind of all that fun stuff and managing the MarTech stacks. There's also challenges with that, but it creates a lot of shared knowledge. It gives coverage, allows people to jump in as needed, and it doesn't necessarily isolate specialties. So we had to break that down. And that's one way we scaled out. I've also seen Team Scale. So we've done a CDP and growth marketing platform on top of our B2B marketing platform, and really trying to scope out, like, what does the team need to succeed? And sometimes it's not that they need to be joint. A lot of times they do need to be separate, and they do need to have scalability and to be agile without impacting one or the other. And so hopefully that answers the question. And that's kind of how we've scaled recently.
Yeah. And when you, a moment ago, you said, and now we still have some challenges. Can you dig into that a little bit? You know, so as you scale marketing operations, what have been some of the unexpected challenges that you've had to overcome?
Oof. Yeah. That's a heavy hitting question. I think there's a lot of unknowns. So for us, this was the first time we integrated a CDP and growth marketing platform, like closely with the product. We didn't know what to, I mean, we did the best we could with a discovery document, had a very technical requirement doc going into it and what we really wanted to see. But there's a lot of unknowns, right? You're dealing with customer data sets and sensitive customer data sets too, right? And you want to be sensitive. You want to make sure you're only accessing information that you need and you're being respectful of privacy and all that fun stuff. And so as we built that, some of the challenges we run into is how marketers think of certain fields isn't how product thinks of certain fields. And maybe there's legacy data and date fields that we can't operationalize and change because it's in a core data set that we don't own. And so how do you overcome that? Like, we're able to build out like a separate data set within our CDP and our own fields and really normalize all the data for our usage and streamline it. But that was a hiccup that we ran into. And I would say the biggest thing that kind of blew my mind is when I think of marketing ops, I've been in the B2B space for so long, and this is the first time that it's really B2B to C or B2B mm-hmm. to members.
Yeah.
And the tech stacks, I mean, all marketing operation automation platforms are pretty similar, but growth marketing operation platforms are a whole nother beast. Like what I would consider standard in the B2B realm doesn't exist in the member growth marketing realm. Like they don't have forms or landing pages in their operational programs or API calls, right? And I think partially it's because it's a maybe like a younger industry, like it's still evolving pretty rapidly. But we've had to overcome a lot of those challenges, like what an operational campaign is to a B2B person and bring it into a B2C environment. It's taken a lot of custom work to get there, and maybe some skill sets that we didn't know we need. Like we didn't know that maybe that manager needed to really understand API calls, right, and how to write these within a platform and mess with JavaScript and JSON objects. And so it's been a learning. Luckily, I have absolute rock stars on the team, and we've been able to pick it up. But there was a lot of fun on scoped learning that we've been doing the last few months.
Well, and I also think that, as you just described, one of the challenges that it would seem to me is, particularly as you mentioned, it's not just B2B, it's B2B to C or B2B to member, as you described. The way that you are communicating the content, we spoke about this a little bit earlier, whether it's physical or digital, but it's scaling out and building out a successful content strategy, particularly in your case globally, mm-hmm. has got to be a challenge. So can we talk a little bit about that, where as you're thinking about the content and the various audiences that you're targeting, what have been some of the roadblocks that you've hit along the way in creating a successful content strategy globally?
Yeah, I think as we look at how we create content strategy, you know, we have a wonderful content team and marketers that really address it. But as you look at how you operationalize it and you think about how you're kind of deploying, whether it's emails or scoring or alerts or whatever it is within your nurture and your content strategy, we kind of took a step back, and what we did on the B2B side in particular is we were like, all right, like let's look at our conversion metrics. Like we need a content strategy. At the time, we had a really old school nurture. We weren't sure how it wasn't set up with any success statuses. We weren't sure how it was working. And so we took a step back and we said, all right, like let's look at our funnel from lead to MQL to opportunity. Like what are our conversion metrics? What are the personas within those metrics? What's the average number of touch points? And really went there, then mapped our content to it and really deployed it that way. And we try to look at like more so around like tofu and mofu and bofu, right? Like awareness. So we have an awareness stage, and how we measure success really isn't like how many people click and open the email. It's what's the conversion percentage from lead to MQL. Is it increasing that? Are we seeing increased revenue, kind of revenue attribution? Are we actually impacting bottom line, or are we just sending out emails? And we've had to do this on both sides. Same with the members. We have an awesome growth marketing team. And at the end of the day, right, that's what they're focused on. Are people actually accessing the benefits versus are they just opening up emails? And we've had to adjust our content strategy around that pretty drastically and do some testing on both sides. And I think at the end of the day, as long as you're marching towards whatever that golden KPI is for you, whether it's revenue or how many people are creating carrot plans or accessing family forming benefits, that's kind of where you march to. And then you look at your content, align it to those personas, and try to do some personalization, really. It's like, how personalized can you make it so that we're really moving people across the funnel.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. Well, and I liked your comment about, you know, conversion percentage from lead to MQL. Is that going up? Is that going down? It just gives you a sense, a pulse of where you're at, what you're doing. Is this being effective? It may not necessarily translate to a sale just yet, but is your tofu, to your point, is that top of funnel activity, is it actually, you know, growing? Is it being effective? And where is it sticky along the way, where you've got to make some other improvements? Oh, you know, it's holding up here. We're not converting over to SQL, or we're getting so many MQLs, but nothing's translating over to sales. What, you know, there's got to be some stickiness somewhere that's slowing you down. And would you say that that's on the content side. Would you say that campaigns, do you have similar challenges when you're actually crafting a very specific campaign? Are there similar challenges, or have you found there's different challenges?
Yeah, so we do it for all of our campaigns and all of our channels. We try to look, like, what's the conversions? Like, let's say we're just looking at paid digital, right? How many leads are coming in? What turns those MQLs? Are they turning into opportunities? Are they influencing buying committees? And so we try to look through that lens for every channel. And I think there is some, there's always some gray area. For instance, I always beat up on this channel internally, and I think a lot of people, marketers do, is content syndication, right? Like, the old school methodology of content syndication was like, hey, I need a bunch of leads that I'm going to turn into MQLs, I'm going to buy this huge content syndication list and pass off to my SDRs, and it's no longer my issue, right? And that is true if you're only looking at leads and MQLs, but what you find out really quick is you can have all the leads and MQLs you want, but if it doesn't turn into revenue and your sales team's not taking the leads, it's kind of pointless. Mm-hmm. So we've taken that lens with content syndication and thought, how can we deploy it like a little bit more strategically? Can we only do it to ABM or target accounts? Can we only get certain buying committee members? Can we verify that it's really net new people and personas that the sales team wants to do? As well as we did look at the issue around, hey, we have all these leads coming from content syndication and they're not MQLing because they're not engaging. They don't know who we are. So how do you put them in an awareness drip and really make sure you understand that they're interacting with us and they read our content and that we can add value to them? And so, yeah, we do it for our channels. It's always, every channel is unique and it's always challenging to really pinpoint it. But I think as long as you're really looking through the funnel and you're trying to anchor on revenue or on influence, that's kind of the true north, and it works pretty well.
Mm-hmm. That's excellent. On the campaigns that you just mentioned, can you think throughout your career? Can you share a story, you know, about maybe one of your favorite campaigns? You know, maybe either at Carrot or at any previous career experience, and what maybe made that successful?
Yeah, I think one of my favorite ones that I ever did was one of the first ones. I was a specialist at the time, and I had a brilliant boss who came from the content world. He was like, I think he was like chief evangelist was his title, and he was also the head of marketing. Really smart guy, and he came up with this idea of like, we were in a super high tech industry. It was a global traffic management. It's really IT DevOps is really boring probably to me and you, and we wouldn't understand any of it, right? I didn't, and I worked at the company. I like could never really click in. And we had this great idea of like, let's do an awareness campaign around content delivery networks and really break it out. So we broke it out into 3 eBooks and then to like 7 blogs. And essentially, if you interacted with one of the blogs or the eBooks, you'd be putting a drip for the other two. And at the end, it was all around selecting the right content delivery network, which was like Akamai and Fastly. If you're familiar with them, and we offered this tool at the time that it was based on real user measurements where you could see like, what's the latency, right? And so at the end, you learn all about how to select the right CDN, and then we show you our tool for free and say, look, hey, you can compare any CDN. And then what the hole we were trying to poke and raise awareness around the issue is it doesn't really matter your CDN. They all have downtimes, right? You really need a global traffic management solution. You really need multiple CDNs or clouds. And I always thought it was super genius of them. It worked really well. We got a lot of positive reception. And if you've ever had to market to DevOps or IT Ops, they are some of the hardest people. They don't care what you're selling. They don't want none of it. And so it was like really good. We had a lot of positive feedback from actual DevOps folks. And I always just thought that was a really cool campaign. I haven't been able to replicate it in my current field, but that was a really fun one to do and like kind of really opened my mind to like, if you really get into the content strategy and adding value and raising awareness and giving tools that are actually going to impact their decision, you're just building trust, right? You're building equity with them. And I always loved that. That was a really cool campaign.
That's what a great story and an example. My mind is sort of spinning right now about what that would be on the receiving end, how cool that would have been. Also, my mind today, of course, goes to cybersecurity and wondering about building security into that and what those what incorporation of that campaign could have been in that. So thanks so much for sharing. I appreciate that. So Eric, yes. Let's switch over to maybe one final topic today, and I really want to get your views on people. So how do you go about building a successful team and creating a positive team atmosphere?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of theories or methodologies. For me, when we do hiring, we really try to hire people you can trust that you're going to get on with. I mean, you're stuck with these people for 40 hours a week, for better or worse, right? That's your ride or die companion. At least when I make hiring choices, that's how I try to view it. And oftentimes with marketing ops, as many people that are listening and you are probably familiar with, is there's a major talent shortage. So you want to make sure that people can get in, they're going to learn, they have the right personality, they're upbeat, they're positive, and that's okay. Like, we're going to be making mistakes. We make mistakes all the time. I do. My teammates do. It's all learning. And so I think really we've done quite a really good work. I'm super stoked on the team I'm currently with. And so we do offsites. We have some good team meetings. The last offsite we did was phenomenal. It was like just 2 days of planning where everybody got to really pick the direction we're going as a marketing ops organization and like weigh in on what we want down. And I think part of that really is you try to build these teams, because marketing ops is super multifaceted. You're working with a ton of different stakeholders, is really just giving people autonomy, right? You need to be able to trust them. You got to make sure that they're going to be able to make their own decisions. Give them a choice on what they want to work on. The biggest mistake I see with teams and disgruntledness and marketing ops is they turn into people that are just doing list uploads or just doing emails. And if you do that to your marketing ops, you're doing a total disservice, because these are some of the best people you work with. They're super close to the data. They're close to the systems. They really understand what's going on. So I think, really treat people how you want to be treated, provide autonomy, give them challenging projects they're going to want to work on, make sure... just make sure you're there for them. You're going to support them. And that when there's issues, it's okay. Like, we're all going to move forward together. As long as you're doing that, I feel like the team's going to do right by you.
Excellent advice. Quite salient, particularly now. I think it's really good to have that. So before we wrap up today's episode, what is the main takeaway that you want to leave our listeners with in understanding the challenges facing marketing operations executives today?
Yeah, I think just over the last 6 years or 7 years since I've been in marketing ops, there's been a drastic change of what even marketing ops is. And so one of the challenges is, like, if you ask 10 of these different companies what is marketing ops, they probably all give you 10 different answers and 10 different expectations. It is a challenge, but it's also more of an opportunity. We used to, way back when, right, it was emails. You were the nerdy, for lack of a better term, marketer on a demand gen team. And now we're usually our own department. We're working across tech stacks, across teams, providing value from lead scoring and nurturing, and how do you do data normalization, and what should your ABM strategy is. And I think it is a big challenge, right? And so just the constant learning, staying up to date with what's going on, and just having the flexibility to really run with it, I think that is a challenge. But it's also an opportunity. Those are the people that are going to succeed in marketing ops, people that are willing to jump in and get their hands dirty across any problem. And so I think it's a challenge, but it's also a really cool opportunity. That's why I love marketing ops, and I think a lot of people do, is it is always changing. What it looks like today in 5 years, I could be doing totally different things and I wouldn't even know it, right? Or in today's state.
Well, that wraps up this episode of The Art of Marketing Operations. Thank you so much for joining us today, Eric.
Yeah, thank you, Glenn. This was a blast.
Well, until next time, stay safe, take care, and thank you for listening.
Thank you for listening to The Art of Marketing Operations, brought to you by Taylor. Don't forget to hit subscribe in your favorite podcast player. If you enjoyed this episode, please rate, review, and share. Until next time.